strength of flesh and bone. But in the costly wounds of love at the cross, my worth is not in skill or name, in win or lose, in pride or shame, but in the blood of Christ that flowed at the cross. I rejoice in my Redeemer, greatest treasure, wellspring of my soul. I will trust in him no other, my soul is satisfied in him.
Well, good morning, everyone. Welcome in the name of the Lord. It's wonderful to have you here with us this morning to sing and to pray, to gather around the word of the Lord. And the good Lord does command us, tells us to gather with the saints. We easily forget the work that Jesus Christ has done on our behalf. So we are told to remember. We see that as we've been going through the sermon on children. He tells us to remember. To remember for our sake and for the sake of our children, to remember what he's done for us. So I invite you, as we sing, to humble yourself at the cross, to look to Jesus Christ for the forgiveness of your sins and the hope of new life, and to have a wonderful time of fellowship with the saints afterwards. Before we begin our songs, I'd invite you to stand with me, and I have a psalm up on the screen that perhaps you'd say with me to help focus our minds and our thoughts on Jesus and his work. So what I invite you to stand, and we'll read this out together. This is from Psalm 24, verses 1 to 6. The earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof, the world and those who dwell therein, for he has founded it upon the seas and established it upon the rivers. Who shall ascend the hill of the Lord? And who shall stand in his holy place? He who has clean hands and a pure heart, who does not lift up his soul to what is false, who does not swear deceitfully, he will receive blessing from the Lord and righteousness from the God of his salvation. Such is the generation of those who seek him, who seek the face of the God of Jacob. Selah. This first song is Christ, our hope in life and death.
Is our hope in life and death? Christ alone, Christ alone.
What is our only confidence?
That our souls to him belong.
Who holds our days within his hand? What comes apart from his command? What will keep to the end, the love of Christ in which we stand. Oh, sing hallelujah, our hope springs eternal. Oh, sing hallelujah, now and ever we confess Christ our hope.
Troubled soul, God is good, God is good.
Where is his grace and goodness known?
In our great Redeemer's blood,
who holds our faith when fears arise,
who stands above the stormy trial,
who sends the waves that bring
to the grave, what will we sing? Christ, he lives, Christ, he lives.
And what reward will heaven bring?
Everlasting life with him.
There we will rise to meet the Lord,
and sin and death will be destroyed,
and we will feast ours forevermore.
Oh, sing hallelujah, our hope springs eternal.
Oh, sing hallelujah, now and ever we confess Christ our hope.
Thank you for the opportunity and privilege that is to gather with the saints this morning. We pray as we sing and as we pray, as we gather around your word, that you might be pleased to form obedience and faith in our lives. Father, I thank you for each of my brothers and sisters who've come to worship. I pray that you might encourage them, challenge them in their sin, and help them look to you, Jesus Christ, as the one who has brought about forgiveness and new life for them. In Jesus' name, amen. This song is His Mercy Is More.
Mm-hmm.
could remember no wrongs we have done. Omniscient, all knowing, in God's not there some thrown into a sea without bottom or shore. Our sins, they are many, His mercy is more. What patience would wait as we constantly roam? What Father so tender is calling us home. He welcomes the weakest, the vilest, the poor. Our sins, they are many, His mercy is more. Praise the Lord, His mercy is more. Of kindness He lavished on us. His blood was the payment, His life was the cost. We stood neath a debt we could never afford. Our sins, they are many, His mercy is more. Praise the Lord, His mercy
a seat for a moment. I'll quickly go through some announcements. A few weeks ago, a number of people went out to Camelwheel to help Hazel, and Hazel has graciously written us this oversized card to Mount Isa Baptist Working Bee Team. Deeply appreciate your help in the flood cleanup. Hazel, Thelma, and Cyril. So if someone wants to take this home who went, maybe you could put a magnet and put it on your fridge. With everything else that's on your fridge. So thank you for everyone. We also had a few people yesterday clean up the top hall. I thought the top hall was going to need a paint, but it just needed a good clean. Getting all the dust off made it significantly brighter. And thank you to Christy for organising the women's KYB dinner through the week. I believe that was a wonderful time for the women. Just a few announcements through the week. Carl's not here. I was going to ask him. I'm not sure if the youth Bible study is on. It's usually on a Sunday after lunch, so I presume it is, unless anyone's heard otherwise. Just a quick meeting after the service for the Kids Holiday Club in September. This is basically just to get an idea of who plans to be there, to discuss what week is going to work best, and just to give out some general direction. It's quite a lot of work to put it together. I believe it's our men's hanger night this Tuesday night.
Yes.
So that's at 6:30 at the Mount Isa hangar. You can ask myself or Gary for directions. $10 for a big dinner and drinks as well. And I believe that's it. Have you got something for us, Christy?
Hi, everybody. Yes, thanks to the ladies that came along on Thursday night. It was such a lovely evening. Great blessing to have the guests from KYB with us, and a huge thanks to Sarah for her help. Next up on the Women's Ministry agenda is the ANEW Conference, which is happening in Longreach on the 9th and 10th of June. I've got some little brochures here that I can hand out today. But if you definitely want to come, early bird registration ends tomorrow, so you'll save $10 by registering now. If you haven't made up your mind just yet, and you register a bit later, it'll just cost you a bit, $10 extra, but not too big a deal, I guess. If you are thinking about coming or would like to come, please come and let me know, because we're going to put together a bit of a carpool and book some accommodation together to save a bit of money. Plus, it'll be more fun if we all go together. So please come and speak to me if you are seriously considering coming, or if you would like any more information that might help you make up your mind. 9th and 10th of June, which I believe is about 6 weeks away, so it's sneaking up on us. So we'd love to have as many of you come as possible. It'd be great to support the Queensland Baptist women who go to so much trouble to put these conferences together for remote areas, and it'd be really nice to go to Longreach and fellowship with our sisters there too. We'll hang around for church on the Sunday morning and before we come back, so it'll be nice to join in there as well. So yeah, come and see me if you want to know any more.
Thank you. I don't believe there's any other announcements, so I'll get if we got some helpers to help take up the offering. I know many of you give online. If you perhaps you're new here, or you're wanting to know other options to give online, you can go to mountisabaptist.com.au/give, and there'll be some details there. But thank you to our helpers. Not time for the kids yet. We'll sing two more songs and then we'll let the kids go out. So we'll make a start. So if you'd like to stand with me and we'll sing. And kids, my girls know these songs very well. These are songs that you kids can help us sing really loudly with. Nothing but the blood of Jesus.
Can wash away my sin, nothing but the blood of Jesus. What can make me whole again, nothing but the blood of Jesus. Oh,
'Tis so sweet to trust in Jesus.
So sweet to trust in Jesus, just to take Him at His word, just to rest upon His promise, just to know, thus saith the Lord. Jesus, Jesus, how I trust Him, how I prove Him more and more. Precious Jesus, oh, for grace to trust Him more.
Oh, how sweet to trust in Jesus, just to trust His cleansing blood, just in simple faith to plunge me neath the Jesus, Jesus, how I trust Him, how I prove Him more and more. Jesus, Jesus, precious Jesus, oh, for grace to trust Him more.
Just as sweet to trust in Jesus, just from sin and self to cease, just from Jesus simply taking life and rest and joy and peace. Jesus, Jesus, how I trust Him, how I proved Him more and more. Jesus, Jesus, precious Jesus, oh, for grace to trust Him more.
I'm so glad I learned to trust Thee, precious Jesus, Savior, friend, and I know that Thou art with me, will be with me to the end. Jesus, Jesus, how I trust Him, how I prove Him more and more. Jesus, Jesus, precious Jesus, oh, for grace to trust Him more. Jesus, Jesus, how I trust Him, how I prove Him more and more. Jesus, Jesus, precious Jesus, oh, for grace to trust Him more. I invite you to grab a seat, and boys and girls, if you want to find your leader and head out, and make sure, parents, that when you do come in the morning, to check them in the tablets if you haven't done so. They'll get them up at the top if you haven't done so. So, and I invite Ness in a moment to read our Bible reading. Our Bible reading is from Deuteronomy chapter 6, verses 1 to 9.
All right, Deuteronomy 6, verses 1 to 9. Now this is the commandment, the statutes and the rules that the Lord your God commanded me to teach you, that you may do them in the land to which you are going over to possess it, that you may fear the Lord your God, you and your son's son, by keeping all his statutes and his commandments, which I command you, all the days of your life, and that your days may be long. Hear therefore, O Israel, and be careful to do them, that it may go well with you, and that you may multiply greatly, as the Lord, the God of your fathers, has promised you, in a land flowing with milk and honey. Hear, O Israel, the Lord your God, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your might. And these words that I command you today shall be on your heart. You shall teach them diligently to your children and shall talk of them when you sit in your house and when you walk by the way and when you lie down and when you rise. You shall bind them as a sign on your hand and you shall be as frontlets between your eyes. You shall write them on the doorposts of your house and on your gates.
Good. Let me pray. Well, Father, we pray that you would grant us wisdom and understanding according to your word. Teach us to fear you so that we might live holy and obedient lives. Amen. Well, in this series, we've been considering the war that's been taking place for the hearts and minds and souls for our children, and in the midst of that, our need to raise them correctly. It is the intent of the evil one to extinguish the lives of our children or children shortly before they are born. And in so scripture, we've read of child sacrifice with its modern-day equivalent today with abortion. Just this week, I was shocked to read that in the Netherlands, the euthanasia law there has been extended to cover children. And parents can make a decision to euthanize their children under certain conditions. So it's very shocking just how far this has gone. Now, Francis Schaeffer, in his book, Whatever Happened to the Human Race, notes that nations that take no issue with aborting their children will have no issues later on with abusing their children. He notes that from his perspective, that abortion led to a more violent and a more dehumanizing society. That was in the late 70s and the 80s. He observed, the Supreme Court ruling that legalized abortion and the arbitrariness of the decision regarding who or who is not a person have broken down barriers. There has been a drastic rise of crimes against children since abortion on demand became legal. We are convinced that this increase is caused in part by the liberalization of abortion laws and the resultant drastic lowering of the value placed on human life in general and on children's lives in particular. So a society that dehumanizes children will abuse their children and become a more violent place for children in general. That includes physical, sexual, and emotional abuse and neglect. Now, on the other hand, Christianity values life from conception and all the way to the grave. But as we look around us, we know that the Christian consensus, the value that Christianity places on human life, has been actively thrown away and being replaced with what is best called humanism. Humanism makes man, not God, makes us the measure of all things, and really has no foundation for the value of human life. It dehumanizes life and dehumanizes the most vulnerable. And so we've seen as we've gone along that failure to eradicate children at birth, as the evil one intends to do, will then aim to keep our children in darkness, keeping them, distorting their minds, enticing them towards sin and keeping them from the truth. And we've seen this, we saw what would happen with the Israelites as they entered the promised land. They were surrounded by pagan nations, not their own, that often would have at the center of their pagan rituals and culture child sacrifice and sacred prostitution or sexually licentious rites in their worship. So, for example, we see this in Numbers chapter 25. While Israel lived in Shittim, the people of Israel began to whore with the daughters of Moab. And these invited the people to the sacrifices of their gods, and the people ate and bowed down to their gods. So you see there that sexual promiscuity and idolatry, particularly for the Israelites here, went hand in hand. It was very enticing for the Israelites. Ultimately very destructive. And Paul says that in 1 Corinthians chapter 10, that what pagan sacrifice they offer to demons and not to God. I don't want you to be participants with demons. So when the Israelites gave themselves over to the sexual promiscuity in idol worship, Paul says they actually gave themselves over to demons. And it remains the same today. The evil one knows that if it can get our children and our teenagers addicted to things like pornography, that it will be an uphill battle for them to overcome.
And likewise, if the evil one can destroy the self-esteem of young girls and teenage girls to make them feel unloved, they will look for self-affirmation in all the wrong places in abusive relationships as well. So the evil one hates God, hates his good order, and it's his intention to destroy our children and to distort their worldview. Schaefer again writes in his book, Whatever Happened to the Human Race, until recently in our own century, with some notable and very sorry exceptions, human beings have generally been regarded as special, unique, and non-expendable. But in one short generation, we have moved from a generally high view of life to a very low one. Why has our society changed? The answer is clear. The consensus of our society no longer rests on a Judeo-Christian base, but rather on a humanistic one. Humanism makes man the measure of all things. It puts man rather than God at the center of all things. Today, the view that man is a product of chance in an impersonal universe dominates both sides of the Iron Curtain. He's writing some time ago now. This has resulted in a secularized society and a liberal theology in much of the church. That is, the Bible is set aside and humanism in some form, man starting from himself, is put in the Bible's place. What we are watching is the natural result of humanism in its secular and theological forms, and the human race is being increasingly devalued. And so, without this fortress of objective truth, biblical truth that the church should provide, that we should get from as we preach through Scripture, and we look to Scripture as our authority that places the highest value on human life, without that, all hell breaks loose in society. And as we know, it's our children that are the most vulnerable and weakest to what is taking place around us. Now, in contrast to all of that, all that's happening around us that says man is the product of blind time and chance, that man is the measure of all things, the Christian, we here should know above everyone else that we are personal beings because we are made in the image of God, that there is an infinite creator who stands at the beginning of all things. When we were created and formed in our mother's wombs, we were created unique by God. You might wonder, you know, why are my 2, 3, 4 children so vastly different from one another? You know, why is one of my children able to play quietly and why does the other one bounce around the house all day long? Well, it's because we have been created uniquely by an infinite and God with purpose and value. We see this in Psalm 139. O Lord, you have searched me and known me. You know when I sit down and when I rise up. You discern my thoughts from afar. You search out my path and my lying down, and you're acquainted with all my ways. Even before a word is on my tongue, behold, O Lord, you know it altogether. So this is the Lord's omniscience, his infinite knowledge. The Lord knows all things. And then look at verse 7 to 10. Where shall I go from your spirit? Or where shall I flee from your presence? Where shall I go from your spirit? Or where shall I flee from my presence? Sorry. If I ascend to heaven, you are there. If I make my bed in Sheol, you are there. If I take the wings of the morning and dwell in the uttermost parts of the sea, even there your hand shall lead me and your right hand shall hold me. This is the Lord's omnipresence. The Lord fills the universe. His presence is everywhere. So not only did the Lord create every single person at the point of conception, but he knows everything about you. He is ever present through every moment of your life. There is no hiding from this God. You cannot hide from him. And how does God know, or how does he have this knowledge over us? Well, because of what he knows in verse 13. For you formed my inward parts, you knitted me together in my mother's womb. It's an incredible statement about the value of human life, isn't it? It tells us that life starts in the womb, at conception, and the Lord is involved in fetal life development. In verse 14, I praise you, for I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Wonderful are your works. My soul knows it very well. So every human being from conception is a work of God. And then finally, verse 16, your eyes saw my unformed substance. In your book were written every one of them, the days that were formed for me, when as yet there was none of them. So this is an incredible statement as God, as our creator, that God places incredible value on human life. And subsequently, that we as Christians are to have this same view of life that the Lord has as well. And we are to implore, we are to petition, we are to pray that the world around us would have this same view, would have God's perspective on human life. Well, this is such a contrast to the humanistic worldview that we find around us, that reduces people to something less than the value that God puts on people. We can say as Christians that we are not a product of blind time and chance. We have been created by an infinite and personal God. Every person without exception, known or unknown to us, a believer or someone still in rebellion against God, of any age, young or old, in the womb or out of the womb, is created by God and known by God. Francis Schaeffer, again in that book, writes, each man, woman, and child is of great value, not for some ulterior motive such as self-gratification or wealth or power or a sex object or the good of society or the maintenance of the gene pool, but simply because of his or her origin. This is the biblical perspective on the value of human life. It gives us real purpose and value. And it should be a warning sign to the world. It should have been a warning sign to the world at the edge of a cliff that says, life is sacred, hands off. There are boundaries for human life that we as a human race must not pass, that life is created by God and has incredible value. And we move past, you move past these boundaries at your own risk. And when we do disregard God's value of life, his boundaries, what do? We tumble over the cliff and into the worst possible of abuses. And so as adults, as parents, our responsibility to our children really begins at conception. That's when we know that there is life. Isaiah writes, can a woman forget her nursing child, that she should have no compassion on the son of her womb? And God says it's instinctual for a mother to protect. And the verse continues, even these may forget, yet I'll not forget you. So a parent may forget their child, but the Lord never will. And so parents have a duty to protect their children, to provide for them, to teach them, to discipline. We've seen this over the last few weeks, to instruct them. We can't presume on others to do this. This is our responsibility. It's not the responsibility of others. It's not the responsibility of the state. You as a parent have primary responsibility for your own children. And this responsibility is so serious that Jesus gives one of the most dire warnings in Scripture. Whoever causes one of these little ones who believe in me to sin, it would be better for him to have a great millstone fastened around his neck and to be drowned in the depths of the sea. So this is primarily talking about the people of God in general, a warning not to cause another believer to stumble, to entice directly or indirectly someone, a believer, to sin. But the analogy that is used is something that we all understand, that we should understand, that we don't harm children. You'd be better off dead rather than harming a child. Now, in the last message, I mentioned the Patria Protestus, the law that was given to fathers in Rome, who basically gave absolute control of life and death over their children. And so Christians in the first century, the second century, wherever the saints were found, needed to resolve from a very early age to be different from the world and how they would regard human life, how they would regard children who were so often seen as having very little value. Christians from a very early age placed the highest value on life because Jesus placed the highest value on their life. And we as the saints today have responsibility to protect and care for our children as well. And I would argue that even though our own state government says that protection of children is a priority, which it should be, they've really missed the mark in some areas because they're fully on board with dismantling marriage, dismantling gender. And again, this is a cause of abuse to children and their families. So it falls to us as Christians and Christian parents to know that every life is special and we're to think differently from the world. We're to have the highest value on human life and the boundaries that God has set. Now, last week we looked at Ephesians chapter 6, verse 4, that we are to bring up our children in the discipline and instruction of the Lord. And this doesn't happen by osmosis. You know, if I do nothing as a father, or Ness does nothing as a mother, our children aren't going to grow up and know all these things. We need to be intentional to bring them up. And so we wrap up this series, and before we get back to Ephesians, let's just consider what our children need. We looked at a few of them last week. Last week we looked at the need to teach our children the fear of the Lord, and that fear is the beginning of wisdom. The fear of the Lord is the beginning of knowledge. Fools despise wisdom and instruction. And 9 verse 10, this is in Proverbs. The fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom, and the knowledge of the Holy One is insight. So first and foremost, our children need to be taught to fear the Lord. It's a broad statement, to fear Him. Fear Him who has the power over life and death, who has the power to throw the body and soul into the lake of fire. Fear Him, the one who is not to be trifled with, taken lightly. He is infinite and holy, and we are dust in comparison. And this is what our children must know, that there is a God who demands their worship, and that one day they will give an account to a holy God. And if our children are to behave differently, to think differently to the world, to have a different worldview, it begins with knowing them, for them knowing that there is a great and powerful God that is above them. If this is not what we teach them, then addressing their matters of behavior is simply dealing with the symptom. It's damage mitigation. But their default position, without knowing that there is a God, will be to revert to their sin. If we reject God, we reject His order, His law, and anything and everything is permissible. Now, second truth we looked at, or what we saw last week that we were to teach our children, was to teach them to speak the truth. You know, we're to disciple and instruct our children, and that means that we do that truthfully, and hopefully they learn that they are to be truthful as well. Put away from you crooked speech, and put devious talk far from you. So, we're to teach them to build their lives just as we do on God's truth. We're to be a people of truth, and we're to be families of truth, churches of truth, and hopefully that impacts our businesses, our nations, to be places of truth. These places can't function on lies. And especially in our period of time, our world, as you notice, has turned absolutely upside down. And do you as parents have the ability to discern the truth in this period of lies? Can you explain it to your children so that they can know the truth from the errors and the lies around us? Are you a person, a parent of integrity, whose yes is yes and whose no is no? Do you speak the truth to your children and to your spouse? If not, where are they going to learn to speak the truth from? They need to learn it from you. And so if you're not committed to the truth, there's no sin that you won't cover up, and then they will learn that there's no sin that they can't cover up with lies. And so our children should know that there's no place for lies, that lying has consequences, and if they don't, they will cover up any sin. Now and when they're adults as well. And it means that they will likely not go to Jesus in humility and repentance. And so we come to a third reality this week, to teach your children to guard their hearts and minds. Proverbs 3:3. Let not steadfast love and faithfulness forsake you. Bind them around your neck. Write them on the tablet of your heart. And Proverbs 4:23. Keep your heart with all vigilance, for from it flows the springs of life. Now, the heart in Scripture is synonymous with the mind. The center of our being, the center of our meaning, your thinking will dictate your behavior. That's the point there. All our actions, all our perceptions of the world come from our heart and our mind. And so parents have this important task to help teach your children to guard their hearts and minds from evil. And as we know, they will encounter evil, whether that be something online, something shared at school from another pupil, certain behavior that they observe on the TV or from others around them that they could potentially emulate. And our children need to know, to be taught, what are those things that they need to guard their hearts from. And so fathers and mothers, we need to teach our children those boundaries that God has put in place, particularly His law, so that they know where the dangers are. They can go here, but not there. And that they've been warned that if you cross these boundaries, you will get hurt. And so you need to be on guard. You know, what's the state of your mind? We need to ask the question to our children, what is the state of your mind? Is it inclined towards God? If not, we need to look to Him for help. Now, there's an important warning at the beginning of Psalm chapter 1. The parents need to be aware of the potential dangers that your children will face as they continue through life, perhaps as they attend certain university courses or pursue certain career paths. They will encounter people, lecturers, bosses, whatever it is, who is far smarter than them. And a problem which could potentially be for children, and as our children get into teenagers and young adults, and a problem which will be if they're young in the faith. There might be certain job prospects that should be avoided, especially for young Christians, as it would cause them to struggle in the faith. So Psalm chapter 1, verse 1, blessed is the man who walks not in the counsel of the wicked, nor stands in the way of sinners, nor sits in the seat of scoffers. We want to teach our children not to walk with the wicked. We don't want to pursue pathways that will cause you to spend significant time in completely ungodly settings. So teach your children to guard their hearts, saturate them with Scripture, so that evil finds no rest in their hearts. A second point that we should teach our children is to choose their friends wisely. It's closely related to that other point, to guard their hearts, to choose their friends wisely. We won't be able to guard our hearts if we keep bad or poor company. Look at Proverbs chapter 1, verse 10. And see there, the first words, my son, this is a father teaching his child. My son, if sinners entice you, do not consent. If they say, come with us, let us lie in wait for blood, let us ambush the innocent without reason, we shall find all precious goods, we shall fill our houses with plunder. Throw in your lot among us, we will all have one purse. And the point here is that bad company breeds bad character. And so parents need to teach their children about the company they keep. Don't be naive. Don't wish to be a part of every group of friends that you come across. There'll be many people who will lead our children astray. So teach your children to choose their friends, not to wait around and be chosen by another friend group who perhaps has bad motives. Take them to church, to youth groups, to brigades where they can meet people of their own age whose parents have the same desire for their children to know and have godly friends. And again, the father is the one, or the parent in Proverbs, who intentionally teaches his son, his child, about these things. Hear, my son, and accept my words, that the years of your life may be many. Do not enter the path of the wicked, and do not walk in the way of evil. Avoid it. Do not go on it. Turn away from it and pass it. For they cannot sleep unless they have done wrong. They are robbed of sleep unless they have made someone stumble. For they eat the bread of wickedness and drink the wine of violence. But the path of the righteous is like the light of dawn, which shines brighter and brighter until full day. And again, look at 18 verses 24 in Proverbs. A man of many companions may come to ruin, but there is a friend who sticks closer than a brother. You think, well, what's wrong with having too many friends? And the point is that it means that you're likely not discerning in the company that you keep. You're likely not discerning in who has bad company. You are tolerant of everyone, even if their character, their worldview is in fact a bad influence on you. You'll have too many voices speaking into your life. And so teach your children to look for a friend that is closer than a brother, a friend who are loyal, who are virtuous, who desire to follow Jesus themselves and encourage them in their faith. And so this is vital. What company are your children keeping? And so you, as parents, may have to be the final arbiter, the final judge, as their children, of who they can spend time with. Can they spend time with these people or these people? And especially outside of school hours, and consider what they're doing or who they're talking to online. Now, there's plenty of lessons to draw from the book of Proverbs, but let's look at one final lesson before we close this series. And that's the need to teach your children to control their desires. And one matter that we've been looking at the evening service, as we've looked at biblical manhood, is the need to control your desire. Men particularly need to learn self-governance. And we've seen that from Proverbs chapter 5, and the need to learn self-governance to control your desire, especially Proverbs warns of sexual desire. Now, this is a screen grab. You probably can't see it too well, but it's from Mission Frontiers, a Christian publication on areas where the gospel is needed. And it has stats compiled from the Barna Group and Covenant Eyes about porn use, pornography use. These are American stats. I did find some Australian stats as well, but they weren't much different, only within 5 or 10% of these statistics. So just a few points of these to consider, if you can see them up there. That there are around 442 million pornography websites, which total around 370 million pages of pornography. The porn industry's annual revenue is more than the NFL, these are American sports, NFL, NBA, and MLB combined, so it has a combined income of all major sports in America. It's also more than the combined revenues of ABC, CBS, and NBC, combined annual revenue of the major media broadcasters. 11 is the average age that a child is first exposed to pornography, and 94% of children will see pornography by the age of 14. 68% of church-going men and over 50% of pastors view porn on a regular basis. Of young Christian adults 18 to 24 years old, 76% actively search for porn. 33% of women aged 25 and under search for porn at least once per month. Only 13% of self-identified Christian women say they've never watched porn. 87% of Christian women have watched porn. And 50% of pastors say porn addiction is the most damaging issue in the congregation. 69% say porn has adversely impacted the church. And so the inability to control your desire, especially in sexual pursuits, is incredibly destructive. Unrepentant use of pornography, of being unfaithful, will destroy your soul. It will have tremendous consequences on your marriage. It will increase your chance of separation and divorce. It's a destructive and demonic sin that will leave you in guilt and shame. And my hypothesis, it's the cause and the reason for what we're experiencing in the world around us of gender, that it has completely distorted a generation in matters of worldview. And you see there, the stats are high even amongst Christians. I'm aware of two people that I went to Bible college with who destroyed their marriages and their ministries through either unfaithfulness or pornography. The stats are high amongst Christian men and pastors. I do hope that the accountability structures in Queensland Baptist means that the stats are less for pastors and denominations that have high accountability for their pastors. But also note that the statistics reveal that pornography use is rising amongst Christian women as well. And so we live in a pornified world. And we as adults need to get the handle on this issue, because we are instructed to teach our children about the dangers of uncontrolled desire, adultery, lust, and unfaithfulness. And look at Proverbs chapter 5 and see that again it's a father teaching or telling his son. My son, be attentive to my wisdom. Incline your ear to my understanding, that you may keep discretion and your lips may guard knowledge. For the lips of a forbidden woman drip honey, and her speech is smoother than oil. But in the end, she's as bitter as wormwood, sharp as a two-edged sword. Her feet go down to death. Her steps follow her path to Sheol. She does not ponder the path of life. Her ways wander, and she does not know it. So this sin is a trap, a snare that on the outside looks very enticing, but immediately after a moment of pleasure, you will feel the weight of guilt and shame. As it says there, that chasing after the forbidden woman takes you down to the depths. If you remain unrepentant in this sin, it will place you on the path to death and set a deadly example for your children. As parents, we need to control our desires, and we need to teach our children to control their desires in this area as well. again, look at Proverbs chapter 6 and see once again that it's a father teaching this to his son. My son, keep your father's commandment and forsake not your mother's teaching. For the commandment is a lamp and a teaching, a light, and the reproofs of discipline are the way of life, to preserve you from the evil woman, from the smooth tongue of the adulteress. Do not desire her beauty in your heart, and do not let her capture you with her eyelashes. Can a man carry fire next to his chest and his clothes not be burned? That means, you know, if you're carrying this type, if you're engaging with these things, you will be burnt. He who commits adultery lacks sense. He who does it destroys himself. Again, in chapter 7 of Proverbs, again, and see that it's the father teaching his son. And now, O sons, listen to me and be attentive to the words of my mouth. Let not your heart turn aside to her ways. Do not stray in her paths. For many a victim has she laid low, and all her slain are a mighty throng, or all her victims are strong men. Her house is the way of Sheol and going down to the chambers of death. So this is a destructive sin. And because of its private nature, it's hard to escape. No one wants to, it's hard for someone to admit the guilt and being caught up in this type of sin. And so it will keep you in guilt and shame if it goes on unrepentant. And our children need to know the dangers of this sin. I've counseled in my youth group years multiple young men, teenagers, who found themselves in this sin because of their ability to access it in their smartphones, and who, because of their guilt and shame, wouldn't be involved in ministries, they wouldn't pursue young godly women. Our children need to know that God has given marriage as this wonderful gift. But if they or their spouse are unfaithful, if they bring pornography into a marriage, it will create for them a world of hurt, of heartbreak, and broken trust. I dread the thought of picking up the phone in the future with one of my daughters in tears, in heartbreak, because they found out their husband was unfaithful or addicted to pornography, or vice versa, that they were unfaithful to their husbands. This is not the same world that you and I grew up in. You know, we had no smartphones to access these things. It was much harder, even 15 years ago. But now the danger for our teenagers at school is that they have, if the parents aren't aware, they have uncontrolled, can access the desires at the fingertips on their phone. And so teach your children, as we've seen here, the danger of uncontrolled desires and to seek the Lord in repentance when they fail to live up to this standard. Now, there's a whole lot more in the book of Proverbs that we could emphasize to teach our children. So I invite you to go over that book of Proverbs with your children to emphasize the points there. And you'll see some of the recurring themes like I've addressed, mentioned over and over. And you'll see others as well that you'll be able to teach your children. The need to be committed to your work, to not be lazy. The need to be wise with your money. The correct use of your tongue and your words. It's all there. And so to wrap it up, if you don't teach your children, the world will teach your children. The evil one will make sure of it. He will turn your children pagan, just like he did the children of the Israelites and did so in one generation. If you don't teach them to fear the Lord, our children will be more concerned with what the world thinks. If we don't teach them to love truth, to speak the truth, to be men and women of integrity, they will have in them the ability to cover up any sin with a lie. If we don't teach our children to guard their hearts, they'll be enticed to all kinds of evil. If we don't teach them to choose their friends wisely, they will surround themselves with bad company. If we don't teach themselves to control their desires, they will become enslaved in sin and make a shipwreck of their faith and marriages. But the good news is that the work and intention of the evil one is countered and opposed when parents fulfill their duty of teaching and discipling their children for the glory of God. Let me pray. Father, we thank you for your word to us today. We see several realities that the evil one has set his eyes upon our children to destroy them or keep them in darkness. And so, Father, we pray as parents and as a church that we might feel the weight and responsibility. Give us wisdom to appropriately discipline our children. Grant us the ability to instruct our children about right and wrong from your word. Grant us the discernment to know the lies of our age. And please open the ears of our children so that they might be receptive to our instruction. It's our desire that this church might be a sanctuary for children to grow in the grace and knowledge of Jesus Christ. Help us, we pray. And we ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Thank you. I invite our worship team and we'll sing a final song by way of close.
And of course, I invite you, if there was anything in that sermon that you'd like to talk or pray about, you're more than welcome to talk to me after the service or through the week as well. Would you stand with me and sing this final song? This is the doxology. It's a little bit different to how we sung it before, so we'll just have to wait for... Audrey's going to help us with the timings. But let me get a drink first, Audrey, otherwise I'm going to make it.
Praise now forever, Christ. Our
there, Caleb. You therefore, beloved, knowing this beforehand, take care that you are not carried away with the errors of lawless people and lose your own stability, but grow in the grace and knowledge of our Lord and Saviour, Jesus Christ. To him be the glory both now and to the day of eternity. Amen. Go in peace.
It shall live.